With technology causing me to just leave and come back. So, yeah, I'm happy to be back again. And I will start with the next session for today. That is the viva voce or the oral examination. Now, this word or this term is something which causes a lot of trepidation, a lot of anxiety in the minds of the students and also the teachers. It is something which is practiced from a very young age, right from school. And I'm told that these days kids, when they are just little 3 years or so, to gain admission to that blessed all good nursery, have to undergo a process of oral examination or viva voce. So that's how early we are initiated in the process of viva voce or this method of conduct of exam. Now, with reference to the branch of dentistry, let's have a look at oral examination as a method or a tool of assessment. So the objectives of this session are very brief. I'm going to have a look at what is viva voce or oral exam. We'll have a look at the purpose of this method of assessment. What are the merits and demerits of this method? And what can we do to improve? Because as we can see currently, we address this issue with a lot of fear and anxiety. What can we do to improve upon this method of assessment? So let's start at the beginning. What is oral examination? It is a method of assessment where the learner is assessed by means of asking questions. So the examiner could be one, or it could be a group of examiners, typically what happens in the external or the university exam, and they pose questions. And the candidate or the student is expected to provide a response or an answer. And based on that answer or response, he's assessed. A score is given or he's graded. That is what oral examination is all about. So it is essentially a face-to-face interaction. Like what Dr. Lata explained so beautifully about testing the knowledge of the student in a theory paper is when the student is given a written or a printed set of questions. He or she writes the responses, and then we look at those, we read those, and give scores. As against this, now here it is personal. It is a face-to-face interaction. And the purpose of this method is that we are able to test qualities which we cannot assess by other methods of assessment, right? So you have the written, you have the clinical, but you have some other areas where you would like to actually assess the student. Viva voce or oral exam is the best way to do that. So why do we have oral examination when we already have different means of knowing the learner's knowledge? So first and foremost, it gives us an ability, because it is a one-to-one interaction or a face-to-face interaction, to check for the learner's depth of knowledge, to check whether the learner has gained any abilities to solve problems. Analytical knowledge gain or application based, like the example Lata gave. So actually, right, she said rightly, all of us being periodontists, we tend to think alike, right? So if we want to ask something like, what is, simplest thing, you start by saying, do you know about glass, iron, or cement? Right? We ask a question. And if the student says yes, are we going to give him score for that? Are we going to give him marks for that? Right? Something to think about. So if we start about asking, like, do you know the composition? Now, when we say composition, it is a very basic level. It is something which is, lower level of cognition, which is based on recall. So if the student has by-hearted the composition, he will say it. But after the student has said that correctly to your satisfaction, you might ask the next higher level of cognition to say, okay, do you know about the setting mechanism? Or do you know about the app? Like, when is it indicated? And why? What are the contraindications and why? So here you have an opportunity to ask questions which help you gauge the depth of knowledge. How much is it that the student has understood about this topic or the concept? And at the same time, you're also assessing things like application or analysis. If you give a hypothetical situation, so if this is the child, this is the tooth, this is the surface, this is the depth of cavity. And what would you use glass, iron, or cement, for example? And why? If the student is able to justify or defend, this provides a platform where we can assess these aspects of the student's learning. And yes, these are again similar things. ability. So to justify, why not material B or C or D? Why will you choose this particular restorative material given this clinical situation or scenario? So we are checking for, so if the student is able to justify his decision, justify the diagnosis, justify the treatment plan, we know, we are quite certain that the student has understood the concept about why what has been taught to him to the best of his abilities. So these are the points which help us assess the knowledge aspect, the cognitive domain, right? From the basic recall level to understanding level to the application and maybe to the synthesis. So this is mainly about checking the cognitive domain, which we are doing even with the theory paper or the written assessment. Additionally, we are able to check for things like alertness, ability to perform under stress. God knows the oral exam is definitely a stress-prone, stressful area for everybody, not just the students, right? So if they are sitting in a situation where, you know, maybe the patient's work is half done or it's not yet complete and they've been called for the viva voce and there they go face the examiner, you have the internal, you could also have the external, the situation may not be very inducive to the conduct of exam. And at such times, in such a situation, when the student is posed questions, you know, which could be of higher level of cognition and application, how does the student perform? So this is more like a real life situation. You know, when we have the written exam, there is a set of printed questions where a student goes and does a classroom. He gets time to think. So the student, if he is confident about answering question 4, 3, and 5, he writes those first. And then he goes back to the other questions where he's not very sure about how to, you know, synthesize his knowledge and put it down on paper. But this is more like real life because it is a face-to-face interaction. It could simulate, you know, when they're working in a clinic, if a patient walks in with certain set of problems, they have to be able to think on their feet. It is a given that they have the background knowledge, the requisite skills, but there they have to think through on their feet, right? They can't say, okay, 1 minute, let me go back and check my textbook. So ability to perform under stress, being alert, to be able to think through on the feet is what we are checking. The additional benefits of an oral exam or the purpose that it serves is it can help us assess the communication skills. Now by this, I don't mean that we grade them for their communication skills. No, that is not the objective of oral exam. It is essentially to assess or check for their knowledge of understanding and the cognitive skills essentially. But we have to understand, we have to make the student realize that communication is an important component in their role as an oral healthcare provider. Because tomorrow they have to explain to the patient or the patient's relatives as to why they are choosing a particular treatment plan or explain the diagnosis. So this just gives us an insight about the communication skills or the ability. When we say ability to defend, ability to justify, also tells us a brief about the communication skills of the student. And by giving them hypothetical situation, you know, presenting hypothetical situations, and so what will you do over there? What do you think should be the right way to manage this situation or manage this process? So that gives us an idea about their ethics, about their honesty. So it tells us about the professional values and their attitudes. So all this is what we can gauge from a learner. And that is why we have the oral examination going, not just for the undergraduate, but also for the postgraduate. Having said that, I'm sure that many of you might have seen this picture on social media, right? This, unfortunately, sadly, is a reflection of our education system. So what is it that is a concern? Is, are we keeping track of objectives? Are we keeping a track of objectives when we are doing the assessment, especially the viva voce? So objectives of what? Are we taking cognizance of what are the learning objectives of that student for that assessment? So if it is like a post-end exam, or if it is a term exam, or if it is a final exam, do we have clarity? Are we assessing based on the learning objectives of that topic or of the entire course? We have to be very careful about that. Otherwise, it's going to end up looking like the image that we see over there. And also, when it comes to the assessment purpose, what is the objective of this assessment? What is it that we are trying to gauge? What is it that we are trying to assess from the learner? So what is the whole purpose? Why are we conducting this oral exam? These two things we have to keep at the back of our mind. The purpose of assessment and keeping a track or aligning the assessment, the oral exam, with the specific learning objectives or the course objectives. Now, as explained very beautifully by Anshula in the morning, when we talk about any assessment tool, it has certain attributes. It has to be valid. It has to be reliable. It should have some degree of objectivity. It should not be very subjective. It should be relevant, not just for the sake of I love to ask questions. No, what is the relevance? What is the significance of that method of assessment? And is it feasible? Is it feasible? Is it possible to do that? Is it possible to conduct an exam? So these are some of the ideal requisites of an assessment tool. Other than that, it should be meaningful. There should be some sense into why and how we are conducting that method of exam, especially when it comes to the Viva Voce. And yes, we have to give some credit to not just ourselves who are conducting the exam, but also the learners. What is the degree of acceptability of this method of assessment by the learners? So we have to work towards achieving these requisites so far as is possible. It's never going to be easy. It's never going to be that we achieve 100% satisfaction pertaining to all these criteria or attributes. But we should definitely be aware of them, and we should definitely be working towards them when we plan to conduct an oral exam or a Viva Voce. Does this look familiar much? Unfortunately, yeah. This is a setting of an oral examination. So here you have these four. So looking at this picture, it is typically that of a university exam or a final exam, maybe for an undergraduate or maybe for a postgraduate. Sadly, this is what it looks like, right? And this is a depiction of the student or the learner or the candidate who has come in. And at the end of the exam, oftentimes, this is what he looks like. This is a depiction. So now let's have a look at the so commonly used method of assessment. What are the drawbacks? What are the limitations or demerits of this method? As you can see in this picture, it is something which is definitely going to introduce a lot of stress in our students. First and foremost, it is subjective. There is excessive subjectivity in this method of assessment. It is far from being objective. Oftentimes, if you have an objective method of assessment, wonderful, you're doing a great job. But if you do a reality check, look around us, it is fraught with subjectivity. There is definitely an element of bias. Now, what works to our advantage, that it is a face-to-face interaction, is like a double-edged sword. Could go against the system of a fair exam, because human beings, we do have certain biases. It could be your favorite student, or it could be based on gender. When I say gender, it is, I'm not talking about just the male teachers. It is regardless. It could be based on gender. It could be based on looks. It's all like having favorite teacher student thing. Language. Now, by language, what I mean is that oftentimes we have our students who are from the vernacular medium. Their entire schooling has been done in the vernacular medium. And now they are in a university where they are learning this professional course of dentistry in English, because that is the medium of instruction. So oftentimes these students are good students. They understand the concept, they understand the reasoning, but they are not able to put it across. Right? So my personal opinion is, it's entirely my personal opinion that when it comes to language, we are not assessing language. We are understanding their knowledge, one. But second thing is that the medium of instruction, the way, the medium in which they're going to be assessed at the university level is English. So we have to help our students, you know, maybe at the very initial level, we can allow a bilingual kind of question answer session, but eventually we have to train them. We have to make sure that they are able to answer whatever they know in the accepted language, that is English. And there could be some bias related to institution. So I did my undergraduate from Govindel College, Mumbai. And during those days, for our clinical exam, for some subjects, you know, we had to go to Nair, then, which was a rival college. And so definitely the bias set in. if the examiners were from Institute B and the students were from Institute A, there were problems. But I think today's day and age where most colleges, most students and most colleges have their exams conducted in the safe environment of their own institute, this is not a problem. But that is something to think about. Second thing is about time-related concern. Lata mentioned that when it came to the theory exam, likewise, we have time-related concerns even with the Viva Voce. Lack of standardization. I'm sure you will agree with me that we start off on a very happy note. We are all full of enthusiasm. And the first student is, if I may use the word, grilled for a good 20, 30 minutes. And then you realize, because I know with the MUHS, the typical format is you have about 20 to 25 students on each day, depending on the strength of the class. So if you have to conduct their practical clinical exam and conduct Viva Voce for them, midway you realize that, okay, we do not have time and we have to rush through. So oftentimes it happens that the students whose roll numbers are towards the end, they are just asked a question or two. So there is lack of standardization. If you're assessing a group of 20 students, are we giving them similar time frame to assess their knowledge? No. And this whole process of conduct of oral exam is time consuming. Yes, there is no doubt about it. This is something which I and most of us feel very strongly about. Whenever there is any method of assessment, it's not just the students, it's even the examiners who have to prepare. Like when you have a theory exam, we typically sit down together in the department and we prepare a question paper where there is input from all the teachers, right? As Lata also mentioned. So why is it for the oral exam we don't do that? There is a need to do that. We need to sit together and discuss the format of questions. So if it's an internal exam, oftentimes we do not have issues about this because we might have a list of questions prepared in the department. But often when it is a university exam, you have the external who comes in. The previous evenings, yes, it's a good idea because we are all friends and colleagues, so it's good to socialize. But if we can also spend some time in discussing about the format of questions, discussing about the difficulty level, discussing about the scoring criteria or rubric, it's going to help. It's going to help the students and it is going to help the whole purpose of conducting an oral exam. There has to be uniformity even regarding the difficulty level. If one student is asked a difficult question or whatever is the level of difficulty, the same has to be maintained across board, or all students should be asked questions across different levels like the easy, the average, and the difficult ones. There has to be uniformity in that. Improper phrasing of questions, again, is something. What happens is that students are taught any subject by their group of teachers, right? So when, they are used to certain phrases or terms. It could be when they have an external examiner coming from another university, the terms used could be slightly different, or the importance given to certain terms and concepts could be different. So this could lead to the questions being asked in a different way. I had a colleague for an exam, and he said that there's one question which they can't answer. What is the trick of the trade? So if I ask, what is the trick of the trade to a student, is he not going to get bamboozled? Is he not going to get laughed? Like, what is being asked to me? So framing those questions, phrasing those questions is very important. Another thing is, it's not enough to just throw a word. Like, what is a pixelgenesis? So what is it that we are expecting? What is it that we are expecting the student to say? Is it the definition? Is it the mechanism? Is it the indication? Is it the merit, demerits? Is it about the materials or medicaments used? What is it? The question has to be very clearly structured, constructed, and then asked to the candidate. Sampling is another thing of concern that we all have our favorite topics, right? Or there are some topics that we teach regularly. So we, in our mind, we know automatically more questions related to those topics. So we might end up asking questions based on those. But is that right? if this is the syllabus, these are the list of topics based on which you're conducting an oral exam or a viva voce, it is very important, it is essential that we sample. That means we have questions from each of those topics, one, and we have questions of similar level of difficulty across all the topics. So that is what makes sure, that ensures that we have a proper sampling in terms of questions. The other things which we know is the halo effect, right? So if there is a candidate who comes in, who answers beautifully, who answers all the questions, so you have that effect that, oh, wonderful. And the next one comes in who is fairly okay, but not as good as the previous candidate, then we tend to give him a lesser score. It's because of the effect or the aura of the previous candidate or the answers that he has given. Likewise, we also have something called as a carryover effect. If the candidate, a particular candidate, does not do well, right? Unfortunately, does not answer your questions, and the second one who comes in is able to answer 50% of the questions, in our mind, we will think that, okay, this student is really good. But again, it is subjective. So we have to pay attention to these attributes of an exam and inconsistency in scoring. Why is it that we love the central values? If the exam is out of 20, why is it that I feel happy giving a score, you know, close to that 10 or 11 or 12? If the student has done very well, why don't I give him an 18? Why am I being, you know, so conjuice about? And we all, let's be honest, tend to stick to that central value. You know, 20 hai, to 10, 11, 12 max. 15 to main nahi de sakti. Atla out of the question. So this is again an issue when it comes to scoring. Let's be honest, if we ask certain question, they carry so much more. Like I said, the exam example that I gave of apexogenesis. So if you're asking apexogenesis as one of the questions that you throw at the candidate, that same thing could have been asked in a structured format way for maybe a 10 mark or a 20 mark question. So phrasing and defining what it is that is expected is very important. And this is something we feel very badly about. So Dr. Meenakshi was saying about what she said, that is the first step, right? Be aware of. And it is so nice for all of us that so many of you, so many teachers are so interested and seem to be passionate about this concept of teaching, learning and assessment. It's really nice. It augurs well. And MUHS actually has such a big sell in education technology. And you're now in the same city. So I'm sure you can take help of that and work things in your favor. I'm sure Dr. Gulwe, Madam, will help with all this. But training of the examiners is the crux. So one is being aware, knowing where we need to, you know, learn a little bit or unlearn and relearn a little bit. And then working towards it as a team. It will work wonders. This is what happens, right? We test recall. We just, okay, define, classify, what is this? What is the composition, list? So whatever are the reasons, because of lack of time or there are too many students to be evaluated, unfortunately, reality is oftentimes it is limited to the basic level of cognition. Just remember, recall and state. And we are not really able to achieve what is the purpose of oral exam is to check for the depth of knowledge. We lose out on that important thing. And the time, so if you have 20 students and these many hours, the duration of personal interaction or asking question and answer becomes very limited. And like it or not, there's a bit of this too. It is a threatening atmosphere. We have to be very careful about not downputting the student or really ridiculing the student. So these are some of the demerits of the oral exam. But it is still going strong, right? We have this at every level. We have this at post-end, midterm, half-yearly, final, postgraduates. It is one of the oldest methods, and it is still going strong. Use of it in formative. I would again strongly recommend that formative assessments when we do, we should have oral exam as one of the components. Maybe it could be based on just three topics that have been taught, but it is an excellent way by which we can get feedback. We can provide feedback to the students and we can get feedback about our learning. If there are some areas where a student is not able to answer, we need to revisit, teach it in a different way, and then conduct another exam, right? So this ideally highly recommended to be used as a formative assessment too. So why is it still employed, right? These are the merits. This is something which I've already said. It gives an ability to have direct contact with the learner. It gives us an ability to study the personal characteristics. So what are the strengths of the learner? What are the areas where he or she needs to work upon more? Are they good with the understanding of concept? Are they good with explanation or justification? Or are they good only at remembering things, at rote learning? So it tells you about where you need to guide them more, provide them additional direction or resources, or help them any other way. The advantage, other advantage is that it gives you flexibility. So if you see, so what could, it's again like a double-edged sword, like I said, that if there is something which the student is not good at, we can go back to another topic and check whether he, she has understood that topic well. So it gives you kind of flexibility to go across topic and also to go at a greater depth in a particular topic, which we do not with the written exam. And for the formative assessment, it is an ideal way to give a feedback. Only in the formative assessment. You know, some of us, we get so carried away because we are all good teachers and we want the best for the students. We start answering for the student. If an external has asked a question and we see our student is, you know, struggling to get the words out, then we provide clues with good intention, but should not be done at the summative. But when it is a formative assessment, yes, at the end of the exam, that's the whole purpose, providing feedback to the students. And it's a good learning experience, not just for the students, but also for all of us. On a lighter note, student cannot cheat in Viva Voce. So what is it that we can do to improve this method of assessment? First and foremost, the whole purpose, keep in mind, like I said, what is the objective? What is the purpose of this whole method of assessment? We have taught them, we have guided them, and now at the end of this posting or end of this term or year, we want to know. This is one of the methods by which we want to know how much they have learned. That's it. There is no personal angle to it. And second thing is that our students are not little children. They are adults. They are self-directed learners. They are here because they want to learn about dentistry. So we must give them that due respect. Treat them as adults. Never ridicule them. About asking questions, the questions have to be very clear. There should be no ambiguity in them. And there is no harm in having it structured. Clearly say, what is, like, maybe you could start off by saying, do you know Ellison Davies' classification of traumatic injury? Now, if the student rattles off all the nine, then maybe you could ask them that, what is it about class two? What are the different treatment modalities? And then maybe give a situation, a clinical situation, that if this is what the patient reports with, giving all the details, and then ask them what would be their line of treatment and justify. So that is the ideal way to go about it. Especially we have the luxury of time when it comes to the formative assessment. That would be the best way to go about it. Yeah, this is again something, like I said, it relates to the first. Itna bhi nahi aata, padke nahi aayo, dhyan nahi dete. You know, these kind of things should be avoided at all times, at all costs, because the whole purpose is to find out what the learner knows. It's very easy to throw questions, right? I can sit here and God knows if I am a teacher, I'm supposed to be knowing more. So if I just throw a question at the students, that's not the idea. We want to know that what is it that the student has learned? What is it that they want to know? Another interesting thing what we can do is we can have an objective structured approach, like conducting what is called as the structured oral examination. So why not sit down the previous day and have a structure about how the exam is going to be conducted? Why not list all the questions that are to be asked? So if these are the topics, then we could have these kind of questions to be asked. This could be the different levels of difficulty that we could ask questions. And like how we have the model answers, why not think of about what is the expected responses for each of the questions asked? It may seem like work, it may seem definitely like a lot of work, but then you're taking care of the reliability factor so well, right? And the students, when we talked about, remember the acceptability, if the students feel that similar difficulty level questions are being asked, then they'll be happier about this method of assessment. And they do come to know, right? The moment one candidate goes out, all the others pounce on him to ask, kya pucha, right? So we have to be careful about the questions to be asked. We should have prioritization. So like I said, based on the topic, which are the must know, nice to know. And since our pass fail is 50%, so at least 50% of the questions that we pose, it's a good idea to write down the questions. 50% should be on the must know areas. Again, I'm saying this time and again, everything has to be aligned with the learning objectives. In the course of our teaching, if you have clearly defined the objectives of that particular topic, and then we ask questions related to that, it is a very good practice for achieving our educational objective or goal. For this also, it's a good idea to blueprint. So when you have these questions written down, based on the weightage, based on the prioritization, and develop a blueprint for each exam. We could have set, so initial questions could be on just on memory or recall. And like I said, like we have the model answers, we could have a checklist for scoring or grading criteria. And we could have a standard setting. Because the aim of the exercise is to find out what the candidate knows. We should try and relieve the student's anxiety. Yeah, we often do that. When the student comes in, it's like, good morning, are you okay? Did you have your breakfast and stuff like that, which helps in putting them at ease. And the MUHS had advocated this, right? So to eliminate bias, have a third examiner who is, you know, observing this process of conduct of exam so that there's no bias or favoritism. And then when they realize that having an additional examiner is difficult resource-wise, then it was advocated that we videotape the process. So things that we can do to eliminate bias externally could also be tried. This is something which I feel very strongly about. Share the format with the students. Why do we like to keep everything hidden and close to them? Students are the most important component of this whole educational process. So there has to be total transparency. While teaching, these are the objectives, this is what you need to know. We are just showing them, right? We are the facilitators. And when it comes to assessment, this is what you were supposed to know and this is what we are assessing you on. So share the format with the students. It could be, you're going to be asked 20 questions, you're going to be asked 10 questions. Too much of structuring is also not good, but letting them know about what is going to be the format is essential. Taking feedback from students, teachers, and peers, and replanning. When we have the formative assessment, it is a good way for us to redevelop and replan. So for these assessments also, it's a good idea to have a question bank of sorts. So if I have taught these four topics in the semester, at the end of each lecture or topic, it's a good idea for me to write down the questions that could be put in the theory paper, the questions that could be asked in Vaibhavose, with the structure, with the expected model answer for both these formats. And in the department meeting, we could have, you know, a consensus on that. So just think how easy life would be if you already had a list of questions for the theory paper, likewise, a list of questions for the oral exam in Vaibhavose. So it's like how students know that this teacher asks questions on topics A, B, and C. Instead, if you have a pool now, and based on the topics of the syllabus for each oral exam or Vaibhavose, we have these standard questions. So if they are able to, if you have used this for one exam and part of it is again there for the final exam, and if a student does well, it's good because the student has studied and prepared for those topics as is expected from him. So sharing the format and structuring it and preparing it is a good way. Another thing which I will just share in brief is that if we have these written down, we could have them as color-coded. So if there are five topics, we could have them color-coded, or we could have them color-coded based on levels of difficulty. And when the student walks in for maybe the post-an exam or a formative exam, they could pick. So, you know, this takes care of elimination of bias in another way. So it's like the student is responsible for the question that have been asked. At the same time, they know for sure that the difficulty level is same. And if we are able to give a standardized time frame, then it will be utopian. If you're giving the, so all this is possible at the internal or the formative assessment. We can start, we can make a beginning by doing these things like Dr. Meenakshi was asking, and it will all be good educational practices. Because I know at the end of it all, we feel so concerned because we want to do what is the best for the student, given the timeline or the frames or the resources that you're working within. So it's a powerful tool for assessment. There is no doubt about it. And we should try and achieve the balance between what is ideal, not always possible to do the ideal, but what is closest to that, what is feasible, we must strive for that. It's not easy. It requires efforts. But I'm sure that all the teachers at your college are interested in doing this, what it takes to better the whole educational process. So we can take some efforts for that. And if all we try and employ these strategies, it will make the whole assessment process acceptable to the learners, and it will make the assessment more meaningful. But the question that we need to ask ourselves, that are we ready to change our thought process? Are we ready to reach an agreement or in consensus that, okay, this is the way the assessment should go? And for that, so we have already seen this step, right? I'm sure that some of you have already undergone the basic training at MUHS, and exposure to these kind of faculty development programs is just what sensitizes you. So you might have been thinking about it, you know, intuitively. I feel this needs to be done for this method of assessment. I'm sure you all might have been thinking, or you might have already tried certain strategies, but it's about getting together and working towards a common goal. So once we are interested, there is always no looking back. We can only work ahead and do better. And this will help us in making a meaningful viable OSA. So in my last slide, finally, I would like to thank the KBS General College and Hospital Nasik for providing me an opportunity, Neenal Gurve, the dean. A special thanks to Dr. Bhushan Pustake for inviting me to this two-day webinar. Thanks also to Dr. Nair and Dr. Shah for helping us along the way. I would like to take this opportunity to thank my teachers and students, who have instilled this, you know, the desire to learn more and teach more and become better as a teacher. Without them, I am nothing. And a big thank you to all the participants for patiently being here on the 1st and 2nd of January and listening to us. Thank you so very much. Have a great day. Are there any questions? I would be happy to answer. Or this is my email. So in case there is any resources required, or if you're planning on any educational projects or any kind of help, I would be more than happy to help you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.